Hello, everyone. Happy Wednesday, and welcome to my Facebook Live show. I'm Jacqueline Whitmore, and thank you so much for joining me. Today, I'm going to be talking to my colleague and fellow etiquette expert, William Hanson. And many people, I would assume most people, if not all people in the etiquette industry, know who William is. And if you don't, you should, because he is the UK's foremost etiquette expert. He's also the executive director of the English Manor, which is a premier etiquette consulting firm in the UK. He specializes in dining etiquette, tea etiquette, business protocol. He travels all over the world, and he has written two books, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And most people know William for his wit and his sense of humor and his warm heart, and for his many appearances on television shows. And for those of you who are new to my Facebook Live show, I'm going to introduce you to William via a video first. And if you have ever heard of Chelsea Handler, he is giving some etiquette instructions to Chelsea Handler in this particular video. So I'm not going to play the whole video because it's, I think it's probably 6 minutes long, and I don't want to take away time from William, but I'd like for you to get a little bit of a flavor for his style. So sit back, relax, and let's just watch this video together.
Good afternoon.
Oh, hi, look at you.
William Hanson. Hi. How do you do?
Great, how are you?
Fine, thank you very much. Now, welcome to Fortnum & Mason.
Okay, thank you.
The Diamond Jubilee Tea Salon, opened by Her Majesty the Queen.
Okay, what an interesting accent you have. Where is that from?
Well, it's English.
Oh.
Yes, you've got a very interesting accent as well.
Thank you. It's new way for heresy.
Yeah, it's very charming.
Thank you.
Now, we're going to learn royal protocol before we sit down for tea.
Okay.
Now, you as an American, if you met any member of the royal family, including Her Majesty the Queen, wouldn't technically have to do anything other than shake a hand.
Well, I don't you have to curtsy?
You don't have to, but a lot of people do out of respect.
Okay, but you don't have to. It's not required.
Because she is not your monarch. If I met her, I would have to because she is my head of state.
Okay, I see. And is there any situation where you do more than a curtsy?
Like what?
Like a kiss?
Oh, good Lord, no. We don't want to kiss Her Majesty the Queen. We don't want to put an arm round like Michelle Obama did.
What did Michelle Obama do? Because she has great arms, though, so she probably was just trying to show them off.
Yeah, you know? She sort of put the hand round in the small of the Queen's back and around the
side. On her rump?
No. No, we don't talk about Her Majesty's bottom. You would need I would bow as a gentleman, and ladies would curtsy.
Oh, how exhausting.
Well, you get used to it.
I mean, do you?
Yeah.
Well, I guess people get used to anything, you know? You could be free one day, in prison the next, and then you get used to that.
That's a little flavor of William Hanson, and I cannot wait to bring him on and introduce him to all of you. So in just a second, he'll be with us. Hi, William.
For having me.
Hello. Hello. I have to ask you about that video. Mm. Did the producers prep you and let you know what was to be expected?
Yes and no. So I sort of knew that Chelsea Handler was an American comedian. I'd never seen anything that she had done. And my cousin, who is half American and lived in America at the time, I sort of happened to be texting her. I said, tomorrow I'm doing this thing for Chelsea Handler. And she said, I love Chelsea Handler. And got so excited that I was doing Chelsea Handler's show. And so I thought, my cousin's got quite an acerbic sense of humor. I better just look up what Chelsea Handler's like. And I watched one of her previous episodes and I went, Okay. So
did was that interview? Oh, and you'll hear my leaf blower. The gardener just showed up about 10 minutes ago, so we'll just roll with it. So, so you do a lot of television in the UK, don't you?
Yes, it's Brits have a very interesting relationship with etiquette, because we are supposed to know it all, being British, but yet so many Brits don't. They don't want to admit that they don't know it, which is very interesting. But yet they are fascinated by it, and also, of course, what we have in the UK, which you don't so much have in America, is social class. It is, everything is so defined by social class in this country. And so they are particularly interested in that. But that Chelsea Handel thing was several years ago. I wish I was as slim as I was then now. Lockdown has not been kind to me.
Well, I'd love for you to tell everybody where you're from and a little bit about your background.
So my I grew up in the southwest of England. So if people are sort of looking at the map, it's sort of the boot in the bottom left, or just above the boot, in a place just outside of Bristol, which is a city. And I had a fairly traditional upbringing. My parents always sort of would say to me, you know, always please may I leave the table. I was always made to write thank you letters from the age I could start writing. Please and thank you, very important. And then when I was 12, my late grandmother gave me a book of etiquette, this one here, Debrett's New Guide to Etiquette and Modern Manners, this very one. It's still actually in quite good condition, I have to say, because it's sacrosanct. Actually, it's not in great condition on the back, but you probably can't see that on camera. And she gave me this book, and, you know, to give a 12-year-old, I mean, it's very text heavy. It's not necessarily what I'd have given a 12-year-old, but she wanted to encourage good manners. And not that I was a rude child, but I think she thought that I would probably like some of the finer details. And she gave me this book, and eventually I read it. Someone's just asked which book it is. So it's Debrett's New Guide to Etiquette and Modern Manners by John Morgan. It's published in the 90s. And it changed my life, really. If it weren't for that, we wouldn't be talking today. I didn't jump at the chance to read it. It took me a while to sink my teeth into it, but then it was quite funny. It didn't take itself too seriously. And I thought, oh, okay, so etiquette actually isn't about shouting at people or telling people off or anything like that. There's a civility, as you and I know, to it. And so, but it posed lots of questions. It sort of told me to do certain things, but I wanted to know why we did certain things. So I bought more books on the subject in order to expand my knowledge. And then sort of before I knew it, I had quite a lot of etiquette books. And then I was asked to start teaching when I was 16. My school said, oh, could you just teach the younger years how to set a table? And that's how sort of the teaching part started. And nobody's stopped me since. And here we are many years later.
So what I am gathering from what you're telling me is that you did not grow up in a royal household.
No.
Your parents still work, right? I mean, they were...
Yes. So my mother, before she stopped working when she had me, I'm the eldest of two. Mm-hmm. She stopped working when she was pregnant with me. But she worked in Harrods and various other sort of high-end department stores at the time in retail management. My father was in property and still is. He still works. But yes, it was a very normal middle-class upbringing where values, traditional family values, were so important and respect. But no, I remember a staff saying to me at school before a parents' evening, William, do your parents have titles? I said, well, yes, Mr. and Mrs. I mean, then that's sort of it. Everybody's got a title. But I didn't grow up in a palace.
So you didn't attend private schools or boarding?
Oh, yes. No, so I did. I went to what we were in this country would call a public school, but in your country would be called a private school. So I was fortunate that I had a very privileged education in many ways, and it was at that school. But even at that school, you know, there was no one there teaching etiquette, which is why they had to ask me, a pupil, in order to do it. Which really the teacher should have been doing it. You and I know that, but sadly the teachers often don't and still don't know, mm-hmm. which is why you and I exist.
And are you still the UK's youngest etiquette expert?
Certainly. I think probably when you and I first met, that's how the media would brand me, as the UK's youngest etiquette expert. And obviously at the time that was true. I think it still is. I don't brand myself or indeed encourage that anymore, because I don't feel that at my age I'm particularly, and not worth mentioning. But yes, I'm not sure, there probably is someone younger, but who knows.
I mean, when I started about 24 years ago, there were just a handful of people in the etiquette industry. Now everybody is calling themselves an etiquette expert. Everybody can hang a shingle.
Yep. Well, we did, because we've popularized it. We've made it look so glamorous and gorgeous, Jacqueline. Everyone's wanted to get in on the act.
Well, let's talk about the unglamorous part.
You mean the job.
The job. And I love my job. I know you love your job. But there are some parts that are not so glamorous. What are some, share with us maybe something that went wrong. Something that was well intended but didn't go so right.
I remember actually when I wasn't technically doing it professionally because I wasn't accepting payment, but at school with those younger years that I was teaching, I had 20 children every Tuesday afternoon. And one of the groups, just before I started, a teacher came up to me and said, just so you know, there's a boy in your group today who's got a few anger management issues and some learning difficulties. He's fine, but just so you know, he might, if you sort of tell him off, he's going to react. I thought, well, okay, well, the way to stop that is for him to behave, but whatever. And we were in the middle of doing a table setting demonstration, and I sort of demonstrated it, and then they all went off into their individual groups and set their own table, standard sort of stuff. And he was constantly on his mobile phone. And this was in a time when mobile phones weren't as common as they are now. And I said to him, I said, let's call him Jake. I said, Jake, please, could you put your mobile phone away? We are in a lesson. And he wouldn't. And after three attempts, I then said, Jake, I'm not going to take away your mobile, but I'd just like to see it. And this was, again, in the days when you could access the SIM card quite easily in a mobile phone. So I took out the SIM card from the phone and kept the SIM card and gave him back the mobile phone. I said, you can have the SIM card at the end of the lesson, because that disabled the phone. And he didn't like the fact that I had sort of tricked him. And so he then picked up the plates, the glasses, the knives, and just threw them at me. And I stood there, and I remember standing there I remember exactly which suit I was in. It was in my grey pinstripe suit, which I wore to school at the time. And they just sort of bounced off me. And obviously the glasses crashed to the floor. Not one plate broke, which goes to show how industrial those plates were. But I can remember from that point on, I thought, if that's the worst that a student can do, I think everything else will be fine. And to date, we haven't had any big reactions.
No.
Like that, anyway.
Oh, thank goodness that those days are behind us. But yet, anyone who's in this industry should know that there will be mistakes. There will be people who stand up and want to take the show, and the scene stealers, I call them, and yep. want to tell you how much you don't know.
and it's so hard, because you sometimes find, even if they're not sort of, they're not the attention seekers, but they're just someone that's asked a question. If they disagree with what you say, I find it difficult when they go, oh, but my parents told me X, Y, and Z. And you know that actually, technically, that's wrong. But of course, nobody, especially as you get older and you sort of move out of the teenage hormones, people really respect what their parents have told them. And they don't necessarily want to think that this thing that their parents, especially if the parents are no longer alive, told them was wrong. So it's sometimes quite hard to find a diplomatic way to say, load of rubbish. Actually, this is what they should have told you. That I struggle with that sometimes because I don't want to upset somebody.
Yes.
But equally, I don't want to teach them the wrong thing because I don't want them walking around the streets of London or wherever saying, oh, William Hanson taught me this, and it's complete rubbish.
Well, I have to share my horror story with you.
No, I want to hear
and it. Yes, I once was called by this meeting planner who worked for one of the big five accounting firms here in the US, and she wanted me to train 400 of the newly minted MBAs who were going through a 2-week program of different courses. And this was in Dallas, Texas. So they said, we want an etiquette course for these young people. And I said, that's fine. And I said, how many people? And she said, 400. I said, oh, okay. Well, as you know, etiquette is a very intimate subject. Mm. And to teach 400 people at one time requires a lot of work. So they put me up on this big stage with these big screens like the Super Bowl. Wow. And to add insult to injury, she said, oh, and by the way, you're going to be speaking after dinner. I said, okay, well, how long do you want me to speak? And she said, 3 hours. I said, 3 hours, really? what time would that be? She said, from 7 to 10. So imagine me speaking in front of 400 people who've been up since 5 a.m., in classes since 7 a.m., speaking to them from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. I cannot tell you how many people fell asleep in that class.
Mm, wow.
It was a disaster. And no matter how much I tried, it's very difficult to hold people's attention for 3 hours when you're on a big stage like that. So my motto is, if you're going to be teaching etiquette, do it during the day because nighttime is reserved for magicians and musicians.
And also, especially when they've just eaten, they'll be sleepy because of that, yet alone the fact it's the end of the day.
And they're ready for happy hour and going out. These were young people.
Wow. Yeah, happy hour is not which side is my bread plate, which side is my drink. That's not what they want to be doing.
No, they don't care. Wow. No.
Okay.
So you are now the executive director of the English Manor. So tell the group about the English Manor and what you do for them.
So when I started to teach professionally, so just after school, when I finished school, I was very fortunate to get quite a lot of press coverage, completely by accident. And Alexandra Meservey, the founder of the English Manor and the owner at the time, in 2009, read about me, I think, in the same, twice in 1 week. And she wrote to me and said, oh, well, if you're going to do this, please come and do it for us. Mm-hmm. And so whilst I was still at university, I was then reading English. I sort of, in my doing an English degree, I wasn't rushed off my feet, as you may know. And so I then started to teach for the English Manor. And that was then my job. When I wasn't in lectures, I would be teaching. And I then, what then happened? And then, yeah, I finished university and it was a full-time job by that point. And we'd have things like Downton Abbey, the royal wedding of William and Catherine, and suddenly people were much more interested in etiquette than they ever have been before. And after that, it just became the job. And then I was very fortunate that Alexandra decided last year that she no longer wanted to run the company, and she handed it over to me, basically. And so as well as being one of the executive directors, there are two. I look after the UK, USA, and Europe. Alexandra also gave me ownership of the company. So I'm very fortunate. I've got a strong affinity with the English Manor. And I think Jacqueline might not be there, everybody. Oh, Jacqueline, you're here. Hello.
Yes, no, I wanted to pop out of the screen and give you full-blown attention.
I love it. Okay, that's good. Well, thank you very much. Well, I've done my English Manor story.
Yes.
So I'm very fortunate, and we are seen as certainly the UK's leading training institute for etiquette. And Before English Manners started in 2001, but actually before that, it was a finishing school called Lucy Clayton, which is a relatively well-known finishing school in that started, I think, in late Victorian times. So we have sort of been going for a while, but my association only since 2009.
And so I'm showing everyone the website, which is theenglishmanner.com, where they can check out all your courses. And because of the pandemic, I believe everyone in this industry is going virtual, and we will be for quite some time. And I know that you're in the process of updating all your courses so that people can log in and take your train the trainer if they're interested in becoming an etiquette consultant in their community. And you also offer some very informative and educational and entertaining free webinars. And I think that's mighty generous of you. So I encourage everyone who watches this video to go to your website, sign up so that they can experience your teaching, your style of teaching, and hopefully take one of your classes in person one day.
Well, that would, we love working with people virtually or in person. And yes, and we keep, I think we've got a few webinars at the moment that are coming up. Some are paid, some are complimentary, but we are always updating the offering. So if there's nothing that takes your fancy at the moment, check back next week and some more will be added.
So what is this fascination? Well, you probably know the answer to this. This fascination with the royals. I mean, Americans, I think, are obsessed, especially now that Meghan Markle is now part of the royal family. Let's talk about some of the scoop. Give me some scoop. When she married, or even before she married Prince Harry, do you think that she had to go through a finishing school of sorts so she would have to know how to behave in public?
Well, it's a very interesting question, because literally almost every month now there is a different narrative that comes out. In the book that I'm sure you have heard about, Finding Freedom, that came out 2 weeks ago, within that it talks about Meghan supposedly was offered Meghan was crossed that she wasn't offered lessons. But then a month before, there was a source that said, a close friend of Meghan's, that said Meghan was cross that she was made to do etiquette lessons. And then 2 months before that, it was that she wasn't. So we can't really work out whether she was or wasn't. There was even a newspaper article that came out a few years ago that said that I had given Meghan some etiquette lessons. And I can categorically say I have not, because there wouldn't be as many faux pas if I had. But I think probably that there wasn't, even for Catherine before Meghan, or anyone that marries into the royal family, I don't think there are formal lessons where an instructor like you or I knocks on the door and does the whole shooting match. The royal family would do it internally. It would be senior courtiers and also senior members of the royal family that have been there, done that, and got the tiara. People like Camilla, the Duchess of Cornwall, who has gone through the process of suddenly becoming a member of the royal family halfway through her life, who can say, okay, you've got the state opening of parliament coming up, or you have got trooping the colour, or you've got this event, this is the sort of thing that happens, don't do this, do that, suggest your dress is like this, and passes it on, because they are the ones that can speak with true authority. And I know that happened. I know Camilla did give a bit of steerage to Meghan. But as we know with any of our students or with any advice that you ever give anyone, it is psychosomatic. They have got to want to take that on board, and they have got to want to learn.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, here in the US, we have protocol officers who work with heads of state and so forth and our government. Sometimes they do and sometimes they don't. And maybe they do, but they aren't. People don't listen. So it's a free for all sometimes.
Exactly. Yes. Best laid plans. But it is a shame that things are turning out the way they are at the moment, because one of my friends was actually with the Prince of Wales, Prince Charles, on the day that the engagement was announced between Harry and Meghan. And both Prince Charles and the senior courtiers that were there with Prince Charles were ecstatic and so excited and were so complimentary about Meghan and how that she was going to help modernise the royal family and sort of push it over. It had been getting more and more modern, but she would give it a good push. And so this sort of narrative that the royal family in general didn't like Meghan is, I struggle to accept, because I know for a fact that they were thrilled. But there we go. They've chosen their own path now.
Well, so the as the worm turns, as I say, so we'll see. So we are just about out of time, and I just want people to know a little bit more about you before we go. Mm-hmm. And I know you do all kinds of interviews all over the world, and people basically ask you about etiquette. They ask you about tea etiquette and handshaking and greetings and meetings and so forth. But it's not very often that the press really focuses on you as an individual, and that's something that I would like to do and acquaint our audience with you as not only an etiquette expert, but as a wonderful human being. So can you tell everybody, is there one thing that most people don't know about William Hanson?
Wow, okay. I am obsessed with ironing. I love ironing. I love ironing. It's how I relax. And I have an incredibly heavy and cumbersome ironing system. It's not just a heavy iron. The board has fans in it that blows steam up through the case. So you iron it from both sides. It's got a great big water boiler on the side. It's got, in fact, the ironing board cover is made from the same material as fireman's outfit. So you can actually just leave the iron on it for hours and hours and it just won't do anything. Not that I do that, I don't want to tempt fate, but that's, in theory, you can do that, and I've done it for a bit. So I'm obsessed with ironing. I mean, that may not be a surprise for a lot of people, but ironing is my I do all the ironing in my house, and my partner doesn't even touch it. I do everything.
Aha. Do you cook?
Yes, I do cook. We both share the cooking, but I have cooked for longer. And so I would like to think I'm a better cook, but my partner's also very good as well.
And what is your favorite food?
My favorite food to eat is chocolate, but I don't cook a lot of chocolate. I just do a lot of eating of it. My favorite thing, actually, I sort of change what I like cooking, but I did the other day, I did a lovely hazelnut, peach and raspberry, well, it wasn't really a cake, like a, well, it was a cake of sorts, but it was sort of a hot pudding that you would serve at a dinner party, and that was particularly delicious. So that's my favourite thing at the moment.
Mm. And do you have a favourite movie?
Yes, I like Mary Poppins and Mary Poppins Returns. I cannot decide which one I like the best.
And why do you like Mary Poppins so well?
Yes, no, I'm obsessed. I'm obsessed.
Well, my nephew is obsessed with Mary Poppins as well. He, in fact, has a Mary Poppins tattoo on his arm.
Oh, wow. Okay. I need to, I mean, I haven't gone that far, but I think I probably need to connect with your nephew and we can chat about Mary Poppins.
And what is your favorite cocktail?
I love a gin and a bonnet, which is the Queen's favorite cocktail, which is, I suppose it actually probably doesn't count as a cocktail because technically a cocktail is three or more ingredients, but it's one measure of gin and two measures of de Bonnet. And de Bonnet is a fortified red wine with ice and a slice of lemon or orange, depending on your sweet or savoury taste. It's incredibly strong. The Queen Mother drank it until she died, so no wonder she lived to 102 because she was preserved in alcohol. But it is amazing. I mean, it's a great, great drink.
Well, that's all good information. And I'm sure most people didn't know all those things about you.
Thank you for asking them. They're very good questions.
Well, the one thing that I do know about you is that you're a genuinely kind, nice person, and you're very approachable.
Well, that's so kind of you.
You and I have met in person when you and your family were on holiday at Palm Beach. Yes.
They're here, and you've done your lovely messages to me, which I now can't. There we go. I treasure them.
Thank you. I don't remember when you were in Palm Beach last.
I think I was in Palm Beach last, maybe 2015.
Okay. And I met your mom and your dad and your brother.
Yes, you did. I know. And that was such a lovely, we went to the Breakers, which is a gorgeous hotel. As I know you have lots of connections. And it was really wonderful.
And I hope to see you again. And you have written two books, and I want to make sure that we show those on the screen. One being Bluffer's Guide to Entertaining. That's the newest one, isn't it?
Yes, that was out last year.
And then we've got Bluffer's Guide to Etiquette.
The original, yeah.
The original. And what are you working on now?
Well, I do have, it hasn't been announced yet, but I can tell you this. I have co-authored a book on protocol, which is coming out in October. It should be announced in the next week or two. It's called Protocol to Manage Relationships Today. It's maybe not quite as sort of lighthearted as the two on the screen, but that is coming out in October.
Where can people get your books?
My books, obviously any good bookshop, online or in person, or my website, williamhanson.co.uk, or from the English Manners website as well.
Oh, William, it's been so much fun talking to you today. And
this has been wonderful.
To see you in person.
When we're all allowed out our houses, I shall be there.
Well, and let me just ask you about that. Are you in where exactly are you right now? You're not
in London.
Oh, you are in London. Okay. And are you able to go to the gym? Are the gyms open? Are the restaurants open?
Yes, most of them are. I mean, the gym is open, but you can't shower. Even though the showers are individual cubicles, but whatever. I'm not quite sure that, and there isn't a government guideline that says gym showers have to be shut, because my partner's gym, the showers there are open. So it's a bit weird. So that's putting me off a bit, because I quite like to shower after the gym. But yeah, the gyms have opened a few weeks ago. Restaurants more or less are open. So it's not as oppressive and restrictive as it has been, but things are still not normal. Obviously face coverings are mandatory pretty much everywhere. But we must be grateful for what we can do, because a few months ago, as we know, everywhere in the world, you couldn't do a lot of what we can do now.
That's right. That's right. So as soon as the world opens up again, I want to come and see you. And I always think that we're going to meet in China, because you and I are generally in China around the same time, but you're leaving or I'm going, or, you know, it's.
Well, whether it's in China, on the East Coast, or in London, we will meet at some point very soon, Jacqueline, I know.
Oh, thank you. So, and we're getting some nice comments from people who have joined us, and we appreciate everyone who has taken the time to join us. I do see all your comments, which will go into the comments on Facebook as well. And if you have any specific questions for William, would you please share your email address with us?
Yes, absolutely. It's william@theenglishmanner.com, or if you're on social media, you can send me a direct message, a tweet, whatever you would like to do, and I can get back to you that way.
And you're really active on Instagram.
Yes, it's an effort, isn't it? But yes, I quite like Instagram. I'm going off the others, but Instagram I quite like at the moment.
Social media is a full-time job.
Yes, it is. But thankfully, we've had a lot of time to do it, so it's fine.
Oh, yes. We're all being very creative in this day and age. So thank you very much, everybody, for joining us. And William, I will see you soon. And thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.